It's a great privilege for me to speak with you. I watched you arrive and begin your days on campus, but it's always a great joy to be here and to spend time with you. And I hope that you have had a good beginning. I hope that things are going well. And if they are, I'm glad for that. If they're not, if things have not gone so well, there are better days ahead. And hopefully some of what I share with you will be helpful in that regard. Part of what I want to do, this went very well earlier, but this is part of being vulnerable, using technology. Actually, what I want to show you are embarrassing pictures of me when I was 22. So part of what I want to talk to you about this morning is to ask you to be okay being embarrassed and being vulnerable and a little out of your comfort zone. So I thought I would do this. Actually, I've never done any, and maybe I won't do it if this doesn't work, but I actually have, this is looking more promising, I don't think I've ever shown these pictures to a group of students before. In 1982, my wife Sharon and I went to the country of Bangladesh. We were in college, and through our years of college, we wanted to do something important, something significant. We wanted to, and you can go to the first embarrassing picture. We wanted to make a difference in the world, and we didn't quite know how to do that. So we started talking with the Mennonite Central Committee, and my background was agriculture education. My wife was family and consumer science education, and they said, we have a great place, a position for you, both of you, and so we decided to go to Bangladesh. We had never been on a short-term mission trip. We had never flown to another country. We left for 3 years. And we were motivated because we believe this is what God called us to do, that God wanted us to make a difference in the world. But again, we didn't quite know how to do that or what that would look like. So we went, and the next couple of slides show what we did. I worked with farmers because that was my background. We worked with farmers who were not able to raise enough food from their small plot to feed their family for the year. So during part of the year, someone in the family would need to go away, often far away, to work as a day laborer to bring enough income. One of the things we discovered, and I worked with these extension agents, and we did a lot of work in the community trying to make a difference. We discovered that Bangladesh was at that point one of the most densely populated countries in the world, and it was considered the poorest country in the world in terms of financial indicators, economic indicators. My wife, the next picture shows that groups of ladies that my wife would work with, and she would help them with literacy, but also in caring for their children. Many babies died from malaria and things that could have been prevented, but they did not have access to health care. Sometimes it was access to knowledge. Women had very low status in that country at that time. So this is part of what my wife did. As we did our work, we were exposed to a lot of different things. The next picture. Yeah, so Bangladesh and Indonesia, where we served in Indonesia later, but Bangladesh and Pakistan were two countries that split off from India, so they used to be a part of India, and they were basically the two Muslim countries and most Hindu state in India. Bangladesh was primarily country with as far as the faith background, would be Muslim. There's less than 1% Christian in that country. So we learned a lot about the Islamic faith. And the next picture, which we'll stay on just for a little bit here, we saw lots of things we had never seen before. Transportation. As we worked there, there were so many needs. Things that we felt were not right. It's not right that someone else, that a family can't feed, that parents can't feed their children 3 good meals a day. And yet I can't. That doesn't seem right to me. And that you don't have access to medicine to cure malaria. That doesn't seem right to me. And that there's malnutrition. That shouldn't be. But as I worked with farmers, and we would choose a certain number of farmers, I was aware while I was working with these few farmers, there were thousands of farmers. And as my wife was working with women, helping them learn to read, there were thousands and millions of people. Beggars were a part of life there. Every day there were many beggars, and as we would talk to a beggar, we realized that there are thousands of beggars. When you're in a situation like that, usually you respond in one of two ways. You either become so overwhelmed that you say, we can't make a difference here. And that often happens. We have a goal, we have a passion, we have a vision, and it's so complicated, and it's so difficult that we say, this, I can't make a difference. It's like a drop in the ocean. Or the second option is what I want to talk to you about this morning. And I want to share with you the biggest thing I learned when I had been in those first 3 years as a very young person in Bangladesh. And that is the importance of doing something, of finding one small thing that you can do and doing it. The longest journey starts with one step. A marathon begins with that first step. So I want to challenge you to think about your goals. These can be very big goals, lofty goals, or they can be a simple goal, and I encourage you to have both, actually. But think about this year. You're at the beginning of the year. Where do you want to be at the end of this year? What do you want to set as a goal for yourself? Do you want to be a better friend to someone? Do you want to have more friends? Maybe you say, I really don't have many friends. I would like to have a few friends. Maybe it's academic, an academic goal. I want to pass all my classes this year, or I want to make straight A's. Or maybe I want to become more knowledgeable about some area that I'm really passionate about. Maybe I just want to be a better student. That's a really good goal. It's pretty broad. I want to be a better superintendent this year. I hope that this year I'm a better superintendent than I was last year. And it's okay to have a goal. Talk about how we start getting toward those goals. Maybe I want to become like the Olympic athletes I watched this summer. I want to get in better shape. I want to run a marathon. I want to be more physically fit. Those are good goals, physical goals. Maybe I want to strengthen a relationship with someone. That's important. Or I could have a really broad goal, like I want to eradicate poverty. I want to create world peace. I want to see a world where there is never a war. There's never a need to kill someone else. The next slide has our school verse. And my mind went on this topic as I was looking at our school verse. I pray that this Ephesians 3:18 to 19, I pray that you may have the power to comprehend with all the saints what is the breadth and length and height and depth, and to know the love of Christ that surpasses knowledge. What a great goal. What a great thing to strive for. And if we do that, so that you may be filled with all the fullness of God. Isn't that amazing that he's hoping that we have power to comprehend, if we could understand God's love, we would be filled with the fullness of God. Great goal. How do we get there? The next this slide has, next couple of slides have a passage from Isaiah 58 that I want to share that has been helpful for me as I think about, okay, so how do I get there? We set these nice goals, and how do we actually work at getting there? This is a passage where he's talking to a group of people about fasting. And they were fasting, but the fasting was a ritual they were going through. It really wasn't matching up to their faith. And he's saying, look, your faith, your relationship with God needs to permeate, be a part of every day, every minute of the day, every part of your life. And so he's talking about fasting. He said, is this not the fast that I choose? To loose the bonds, and listen to these lofty goals, to loose the bonds of injustice and to undo the thongs of the yoke, to let the oppressed go free and to break every yoke. What a great set of goals those would be. Then in verse 70, it becomes a little more specific. Is it not to share your bread with the hungry? You can do that. You can give bread to the hungry. And bring the homeless poor into your house. And when you see the naked, to cover them. So provide clothes for people who need them and shelter for people. And not to hide yourself from your own kin. Take care of your own family. These are specific things that we can do. And if we do these, we have these more general lofty goals, but if we start doing something, I love the first part of verse 9, then your light shall break forth like the dawn, and your healing shall spring up quickly. This is what's going to happen if you do these things. So I want to take a little time to think about how we get from here to there. There's a recent Harvard study that showed that only 5% of Americans have written goals. So if you don't have written goals, you're in the 95%. Out of 100 people, only 5 people have written goals. Now, that study went on to show a correlation or a connection between that many of the people who do written goals are among the highest earning people in the nation. Now, I will quickly say, I don't think your goal should be to be the highest earning people. But the things that make us successful in terms of finances also make us successful in terms of helping other people, being very intentional and thoughtful about what we do each day, the little steps that we take. So, the next slide, we'll just I want to talk about 3 things that I have found helpful. The first thing that I think is important to do is to identify a few steps. Identify that first thing that you can do. What can I do to begin moving? And then you take that first step. Rather than freezing and saying, this is far too complicated, no. Identify one thing that you can do. And one of the important parts of that is having a strong team around you. Making sure that you have friends who care about these things around you. Pastors, parents, teachers. If you see someone who's very good at reaching goals, pay attention to those people. Do you know someone who says, I want to lose 5 pounds, I want to lose 10 pounds by a certain date? Now, that's an old person's goal, maybe, but... And I actually achieve that. Most of us have a hard time doing that. If I know someone who, anytime they say, I'm going to reach this goal, and they do, pay attention. They understand how to take steps and reach a goal. Is I don't lose 10 pounds, I don't become fit, I don't develop friends in a few minutes. It doesn't happen. It's a process. Proverbs 15:22 says, without counsel, plans go wrong, but with many advisors, they succeed. One of the things that we discover is that you begin moving as you take that first step, your passion for whatever your goal is increases. So I'm going to pause here and give a multiple choice test quiz here real quickly. So I have 3 people and I want you to identify which one of these 3 persons you would want to work with. There were 3 bricklayers and they were building. And so a man comes up to the bricklayers and the first person, he says, what are you doing? And the guy says, well, what does it look like I'm doing? He says very sarcastically, I'm laying bricks. Okay, so the man went to the second guy. And he says, what are you doing? He said, can't you see what I'm doing? I'm building a wall. And then I realize this is an interesting time to talk about building walls. You hear a lot about that in the news. This has nothing to do with that.
Then he came to the third person, and he said, what are you doing? And the man said, very excited, I'm building a magnificent church for God. As you think about those three people, which one would you want to have working for you, with you? The perspective of the bigger goal, the perspective of where we're going, the thought that I'm not just laying brick, building a wall, that's a little bit of a broader perspective, but the fact that I'm building something, I'm working toward what may be a very distant goal, is important. As you begin taking those steps, your passion and your eyes on the finished product will increase. The second point on the next slide, after you've taken that first step, step back and evaluate the step. How did it go? What worked? What didn't? I want to make more friends. Well, maybe the first step I would choose would be just to introduce myself to someone. And maybe that was really awkward because he didn't seem very comfortable with me. That's okay. It's okay to be a little awkward sometimes. But maybe then I think about that. What could I do as a second step? We remember that God is always in everything we do. Proverbs 16:9, the human mind plans the way, but the Lord directs the steps. God is constantly directing our steps. So we evaluate, we identify obstacles. Maybe I said something really stupid when I introduced myself to you. But you know, it's okay. We stumble. We learn from each other. And actually, I like people who can make mistakes and can still talk to me. If they make one mistake and they run away from me, I probably will never be able to be a friend of them. It's okay to stumble. I enjoy being around people who can make mistakes, learn from them, and move ahead. The main thing is don't ever give up. Finally, if you don't remember anything else, what I shared with you this morning in the third slide, the most important thing is to begin. We often wait and we think, okay, I want to be a better student, but, you know, I'm going to start that next marking period, or I want to make friends, but I'm going to wait a little while. Today is when you start taking that first step towards your goal. If you want an A in physics, well, start by studying for the quiz tonight. Do something to start in that direction. If you want to eradicate poverty, well, talk to someone who's experiencing poverty. That would be one step. If I want to have a stronger faith, a closer relationship with God, take 2 minutes out of your day in quietness and prayer with God. Read 2 verses from Scripture. You don't have to read the whole Bible through the day to accomplish that. You take small steps. You identify something that will begin moving you toward that goal. The secret of persistent small steps toward a goal. So when I was working in Bangladesh, every day I was aware that I was doing something. And it wasn't going to solve all the problems today. It wasn't going to eradicate poverty. It wasn't going to create world peace. But it was a step in that direction. And I believe God is pleased when we take steps toward goals that we set. I encourage you to take time to set some goals. Be thoughtful about this year. Whether you're a freshman, sophomore, junior, senior, what do you want to accomplish? What would you like to do differently by the end of the year compared to this year? Invite someone into your friend group. I can almost assure you that many freshmen here, when you're giving your senior speech, you're going to be talking about best friends who are not, you may not even know right now. Something amazing when you invite new people into your friend groups. But set those goals. Be thoughtful about them. Talk to your network of friends about these goals. And I pray that this will be a wonderful year for you. I want to just close with a prayer of blessing.